Good morning. Today we are going to solve free response question number 3 from the 2018 AP Physics 1 exam. Billy, please read the problem through part A, double I.
Flippin' physics.
The disk shown spins about the axle at its center. A student's experiments reveal that while the disk is spinning, friction between the axle and the disk exerts a constant torque on the disk. Part A. At time t equals 0, the disk has an initial counterclockwise or positive angular velocity omega naught. The disk later comes to rest at time t equals t1. Part AI. On the grid at left below, sketch a graph that could represent the disk's angular velocity as a function of time t from t equals 0 until the disk comes to rest at time t equals t1. Part AII. On the grid at right below, sketch the disk's angular acceleration as a function of time t from t equals 0 until the disk comes to rest at time t equals t1.
Thank you, Billy. Bobby, please solve all of part A.
Sure. Friction is the only force causing a torque on the disk about its center of mass or its axle. Therefore, friction causes a constant net torque on the disk, which causes the disk to have a constant clockwise or negative angular acceleration. A constant negative angular acceleration on an angular velocity as a function of time graph is a line with a constant negative slope. The initial angular velocity is omega naught, and the final angular velocity is 0 at time t equals t1, so the angular velocity as a function of time graph is a straight line with a negative slope starting at omega naught and ending at 0. A constant angular acceleration on an angular acceleration as a function of time graph is a horizontal line. Because the angular acceleration is negative, the horizontal line needs to be below the x-axis.
Very nice, Bobby. A quick point about grading. Part A is worth 4 points out of 12 for this question. That's right, 1/3 of the points for this question are for drawing 2 lines, one on each graph, no explanation necessary. This should highlight the importance of the graphs they ask you to draw. Please draw carefully. Also, I want to point out that I have written on the screen Bobby's reasoning behind why he chose to draw the lines the way he did on the graphs. However, none of that is necessary to get all 4 points for part A. This question does not ask for an explanation, so you do not need to give one. Do not waste your time explaining your answer if the question does not ask you to explain your answer. Okay, Bo, please read and answer part B.
Part B. The magnitude of the frictional torque exerted on the disk is tau naught. Derive an equation for the rotational inertia I of the disk in terms of tau naught, omega naught, T1, and physical constants as appropriate. Okay, the only force causing a torque on the wheel about its axis of rotation is the force of friction. So when we sum the torques on the wheel about its axis of rotation, the net torque equals the negative of torque naught, the torque caused by the friction. And it is negative because it is opposite the direction the wheel is spinning, and the direction the wheel is spinning is defined as positive in the problem. Net torque is also equal to rotational inertia times angular acceleration.
The fishy thing! Yes, Billy and Bobby, we like to call angular acceleration fishy thing. Bo, continue, please.
Because angular acceleration is not one of the terms we need to solve rotational inertia in terms of, we need to substitute something in for angular acceleration.
Fishy thing.
Angular acceleration equals change in angular velocity over change in time. Change in means final minus initial. The final angular velocity is 0 because the wheel comes to rest at the end. The initial angular velocity is omega naught. The final time is time 1, and the initial time was defined as 0. That means the angular acceleration equals the negative of omega naught over time 1. And we can now solve the original equation for rotational inertia and substitute the negative of omega naught over time 1 in for angular acceleration. And we get the rotational inertia of the wheel equals torque naught times time 1 divided by angular velocity naught.
Thank you, Bo. Okay, please realize part B is only worth 3 points. In other words, The first two graphs are worth more than this equation derivation. Do you remember when I said you need to be careful drawing your graphs?
Yeah.
Yeah, understood.
Bobby, please read part C through part double I.
Part C. In another experiment, the disk again has an initial positive angular velocity omega naught at time t equals 0. At time t equals 1/2 t1, the student starts dripping oil on the contact surface between the axle and the disk to reduce the friction. As time passes, more and more oil reaches that contact surface, reducing the friction even further. Part I. On the grid at left below, sketch a graph that could represent the disk's angular velocity as a function of time from t equals 0 to t equals t1, which is the time at which the disk came to rest in part A. Part double I. On the grid at right below, sketch the disk's angular acceleration as a function of time from t equals 0 to t equals t1.
Billy, please answer all of part C.
Okay. Nothing has changed from time t equals 0 to time t equals 1/2 time 1, so the first half of both graphs should be the same as they were in part A. For the second half of each graph, the oil reduces the force of friction, which reduces the net torque, which reduces the angular acceleration of the wheel. This means the second half of the angular acceleration graph should show an angular acceleration with a magnitude which is decreasing. In other words, the line should move towards the horizontal time axis. For the second half of the angular velocity graph, the angular acceleration is no longer constant, so the line is no longer straight, but rather is curved. The slope of an angular velocity as a function of time graph is angular acceleration, so the slope of the angular velocity graph from 1/2 time 1 to time 1 should slowly get closer to 0 or get flatter. And the angular velocity at time 1 needs to be positive because the angular acceleration is less than it was in part A, and therefore the angular velocity will not have reached 0 by time 1.
Absolutely, Billy. Now, these are two more graphs worth 4 more points. That is 8 total points out of 12 for question number 3, all for graphs with no explanation. If you did not believe me before, believe me now. Be careful when drawing your graphs. Bobby, please read, and Bo, please answer part D.
Part D. The student is trying to mathematically model the magnitude tau of the torque exerted by the axle on the disk when the oil is present at times t is greater than 1/2 time 1. The student writes down the following two equations, each of which includes a positive constant C1 or C2 with appropriate units. Equation 1. Torque equals constant 1 times the quantity time minus 1/2 time 1. That equation is during times greater than 1/2 time 1. Equation 2, torque equals constant 2 divided by the quantity time plus 1/2 time 1. Again, that is during times greater than 1/2 time 1. Which equation better mathematically models this experiment, equation 1 or equation 2? Briefly explain why the equation you selected is plausible and why the other equation is not plausible.
Okay. We can determine the torque for each equation at time t equals 1/2 time 1 and t equals time 1. All we have to do is substitute 1/2 time 1 and time 1 into each torque equation. For torque 1, the torque at 1/2 time 1 works out to be 0. And the torque at time 1 equals constant 1 times 1/2 time 1. For torque 2, the torque at 1/2 time 1 works out to be constant 2 divided by time 1, and the torque at time 1 equals 2/3 times constant 2 divided by time 1. But how does that help us? Well, the torque for equation 1 does not make sense because it would be 0 at time 1/2 time 1, and gets larger from there.
The magnitude of the torque should start out at a positive value at time equals 1/2 time 1 and decrease from there, which is what equation 2 does. So equation 2 is the one which better mathematically models this experiment. Put a mark next to equation 2.
Thank you, Bo, and thank you for learning with me today. I enjoyed learning with you.